Dear friends and followers, welcome back to my channel and to a very important topic you are most likely going to mess up at least once in your pilot career: descent planning. How does a pilot know when to initiate his descent towards his destination aerodrome? This is today's question. So I'll show you a few thumb rules which will make your descent planning a lot easier and avoid coming in hot and high. So get your brain ready for some easy head calculations and let's get started. This is undeniably one of the procedures every pilot messes up at least once in his pilot career: the descent planning. Tell me about it. Transitioning onto the Boeing 747, which is heavy as lead and fast as a bullet, will slap you in the face if you think you can fly her like an Airbus A320, which has a glide ratio comparable to a flying piano once you extend the speed brakes. There's only little room to play with once you fly a wide-body airplane. But how is it done? Okay, the times where you flew inbound to your destination airport and just looked outside of the window and then decided to descend visually towards the runway are over, at least within the airline industry. Now, you might have seen these abbreviations in videos about the navigation display. This shows the top of descent point in regards to the entered flight plan in the FMGS on Airbus models or on the FMS on the Boeing. Obviously, this is a great help showing you when to start your descent, but there's a big flaw with that top of descent point on the ND, and I'll show you in an example why, and why it is important to me that you know a few thumb rules to not mess up your approach. Now let's assume we're approaching into Hamburg, Germany. Now we've got the approach set up, but as you see here on those two NDs, the top of the descent points are at different locations. How can that be? Now this ND shows a direct approach towards runway 33, and the other includes a so-called transition. A transition is an approach procedure in order to slow down the incoming traffic and makes it easier for the approach controller to stack the planes, or as they say, pushing tin, before handing them over to the tower controller. So with a transition, the flight or approach distance moves the top of descent to a later point compared to a direct approach, which will want you to descend earlier as you only have a certain distance left over. This makes sense, right? Compare it as if you were driving to your girlfriend's house and she wants you to call her 30 miles prior reaching her house to get dinner ready. Now you are on a direct route, but let's say you need to perform a little detour or a transition at your ex-girlfriend's house. That will move your time of call or top of descent to a later point, right? So in order to anticipate that the controller might take you in for a direct approach, always plan with the shortest distance to the runway. Now the easiest way of finding out the distance to the airport is by tuning in the closest VOR DME to the runway you're flying to. So in our case, Hamburg has a DME station named Alster right at the airport. So we're going to be tuning in Alster, Alpha Lima Foxtrot, and will give us a distance of. Now, as you see on the PFD and ND, we're at 27,000 feet with a speed of 320 knots and a tailwind of 20 knots. Let's neglect the weight of the plane for a moment. So with that data, we want to calculate the distance we need to fly a continuous descent profile. So the first thing we're going to look at is the altitude we're going to have to lose. Now, Hamburg is at 53 feet above sea level. We can disregard that, and so we effectively have to descend 27,000 feet. Now keep in mind, if your destination airport is Bogota, for example, you would have less altitude to lose as the airport already is at 8,300 feet. So we're going to cross out the last digits and divide that by 3. So 270 divided by 3 equals 90. So 90 nautical miles is the minimum distance we'll need for our descent. Now the next factor to consider is speed, as there is no way that we'll be landing the plane at 320 knots. Now we'll consider 200 knots as an average descent speed as you are progressively getting slower over the entire descent profile, including company speed restrictions like 250 knots below 10,000 feet. But I'll come back to that in a minute. So we've got to lose 120 knots indicated airspeed, not ground speed. And a good estimate for most plane is 1 nautical mile per 10 knots speed reduction. So 120 knots divided by 10 equals 12 nautical miles to reduce the speed. Last but definitely not least, and often forgotten but easily messes up your descent planning, is the wind. Now in our example, we have a tailwind which will make it harder for you to lose altitude and kill speed. So for every 10 knots of wind, you add 1 nautical mile, so we have 20 knots divided by 10 equals 2 nautical miles we have to add to our mileage. Now, if it were to be a headwind, you subtract the miles. Capiche? So, summing up our calculations, we should be starting our descent at 104 track miles. As you are in descent, you want to check every 10,000 feet if you're still on the correct vertical profile and then decrease or increase your vertical speed. Speaking of vertical speed, there is another technique you can apply. Now, we'll use 200 knots as an average descent speed as mentioned previously. So we've determined the distance needed of 104 nautical miles. So for easier calculations, let's say 100 nautical miles. That means you need 30 minutes for the entire distance. 27,000 feet divided by 30 minutes equals 900 feet per minute, which should be your average vertical speed. I'm personally not a vertical speed flyer, and I'll tell you why. First of all, 900 feet per minute is in most cases not steep enough for the initial descent, and the controller will be faffing about why you're descending at such slow rate. In the rarest cases, the vertical profile is a 3-degree glide slope from top to bottom, as it is sheer impossible to maintain that slope and reduce speed at the same time. Compare it as if you were coasting downhill a highway at 60 miles if you wanted to slow down but you couldn't use the brakes. How would you slow down? The only way of doing that is if the highway would become shallower. So commonly, pilots start off with a high speed descent at 3 degrees or steeper. Now, just before reaching 10,000 feet, you dial down the speed, the plane pitches upwards, creating a shallower descent path equal to 1,000 feet per 5 nautical miles. Now, once you receive further descent clearance, you rejoin the 3-degree angle, equal to 1,000 feet vertically, needing 3 nautical miles horizontally. Maintain 250 knots until reaching 5,000 feet, dial down the speed even more so you can extend the slats and flaps to establish yourself on the ILS, VOR approach, etc. So your vertical profile is going to look something similar to this. Now, once established on the approach, another thumb rule: ground speed times 5 gives you the necessary vertical speed feet per minute you want to be flying to maintain on the 3-degree glide slope. But for the descent, I primarily use the first 3 thumb rules I've mentioned, and your goal should be, as it is mine, to fly the entire descent on idle power and only apply thrust after the final flap setting. The least efficient thing you can do is if you use the speed brakes for the descent and then you have to apply thrust to maintain altitude before reaching the glide slope. You've then killed kinetic energy for no good reason. That's the point I'm at right now with the Queen, so she's still testing me. Well, I have to admit that sometimes we land with the maximum landing weight and the next day we land with 100 tons less. And that for sure has an impact on the handling and descent characteristics of the plane. Let's look at a scenario which is quite common. The controller won't give you the descent clearance due to traffic crossing at lower levels. So you slowly get over your descent profile. Now what? Now, there are 3 things you can do to rejoin your profile once you have your descent clearance. Increase speed and idle power. Dial up the speed and pull back the thrust levers, and the autopilot immediately will try to capture the speed but without thrust. Now, the only way of doing this is by pitching down. So you and your passengers will feel that descent, believe me, but it's fun though. Try to get below your descent profile as quickly as possible, as that will give you space and time to slow down the airplane again. Now, if ATC advises you to maintain a certain speed, which is too slow to kill altitude, use your speed brakes, the air brakes, or high drag devices, whatever the manufacturer named them, that's what they're made for. A video about that topic is coming up soon. Now, remember the car scenario I've mentioned before. Now you are allowed to use the brakes actually to slow down. Now, you might even use the gear or flaps, but you're most likely not going to retract them once you've used them. And the last resort, ask for delay vectors or more track miles. You ever so often hear colleagues ask the controller, how many track miles can we expect? And he'll respond, let's say, 25 nautical miles. The pilots quickly do their calculations, and if they're too high, they'll say, unable, request delay vectors. So the controller will extend their downwind, for example, to give them more time to lose altitude or reduce speed. Now, you might say, Joe, this is all nice to know, but I'll rather rely on the data I've put into the FMGS or FMS, and I use all the help given on the navigation display. That's fine by me, but the FMS and all the other help cannot anticipate a sudden direct approach given by the controller. And if you're replying, unable, we're too high for the approach, you'll be the reason for many smiley faces in surrounding cockpits, and they'll be happy to nick your slot for the approach. So fly conservative, but also plan ahead. Constantly monitor your distance to the airport, and if necessary, use the speed brakes or extend the flaps or even the gear to lose speed and altitude. As always, situational awareness is key. You'll get a feel for it, don't worry. Also on how to anticipate the surrounding traffic and the mood of the air traffic controller. A go around, cause you're hot and high, might happen as you're unable to establish yourself on the approach, but it's not a failure. It's more of a lesson and you'll profit from. That's it for today. Thank you very much for your time. To become my wingman, hit that subscribe button and the notification bell so you won't miss out upcoming videos. And don't forget, a good pilot is always learning. See you next week. All the best. Your Captain Joe.